Hi everyone, Raif Derrazi here, and this is your latest HIV news video. Today I'll be covering 12 articles covering topics ranging from AGT-103T's success in reducing HIV reservoirs for over 2 years as a hopeful for HIV cure, to Merck's once-monthly PrEP pill, MK-8527, entering global trials, and a bnAb plus N-803 combo delaying rebound in over half of participants off ART, another means to cure hopeful. We'll also explore a single-shot gene therapy for newborns, injectable ART success in viremic patients, U.S. aid cuts hitting infant care, PEPFAR's planned phase-out, and more. All right, diving right in. Number one, The Times. Why HIV rates among Russian soldiers are soaring. HIV diagnoses among Russian soldiers have jumped 20-fold since the Ukraine invasion, largely due to unprotected sex and drug use during peak mobilization, not combat injuries, according to Military Medical Journal, with over 1.1 million registered cases and estimates up to 1.5 million, Russia is already among the top five countries for HIV. Around 30,000 working-age Russians die annually from the virus, worsening the labor crisis, says HIV expert Vadim Pokrovsky. Meanwhile, anti-LGBT laws, stigma, and the crackdown on NGOs, many labeled as foreign agents, are blocking access to prevention and care. While the war disrupts HIV services in occupied Ukraine and threatens regional harm reduction efforts, prompting UN warnings of a wider crisis. Number two, The New York Times. U.S. quietly drafts plan to end program that saved millions from AIDS. A leaked draft reveals the U.S. is preparing to phase out PEPFAR, the 22-year-old HIV program credited with saving 26 million lives, shifting its focus from treatment and prevention to global health surveillance and promoting U.S.-made health products. Countries like Botswana and Vietnam could lose support in 2 years, while Zambia and Uganda face cuts in 3 to 8 years. The plan also eliminates support for key populations like sex workers and gay men in favor of biomedical tools like lenacapavir, prompting experts like Asia Russell of HealthGap to call it a death warrant. Although $400 million was restored for 2025, critics warn the shift toward a trade-over-aid model could undermine the world's most effective HIV program. Number three, The Wall Street Journal. RFK Jr. to oust advisory panel on cancer screenings, HIV prevention drugs. Health and Human Services Secretary Robert F. Kennedy Jr. is set to remove all 16 members of the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, which plays a critical role in deciding what screenings and preventive treatments, like cancer checks and HIV prevention drugs, must be covered by insurance at no cost to patients. Kennedy reportedly sees the panel as too woke, echoing criticism from conservative circles over its acknowledgement of racism and medical contexts and use of inclusive language like pregnant persons. This move follows a June Supreme Court ruling affirming Kennedy's authority to replace the panel, even as it upheld the task force's constitutional legitimacy. Public health leaders and Democrats are alarmed, with Senator Pat Murray warning, "In no world should experts be replaced with unqualified anti-science cronies of RFK Jr." The planned overhaul comes after Kennedy similarly removed all members of the Federal Vaccine Advisory Committee and raises concerns that evidence-based health guidance could be replaced by ideology, potentially making preventive care more costly and less accessible. Number four, The Telegraph. Lesotho mothers fear passing HIV to their babies as U.S. aid cuts halt testing. In Lesotho, where HIV rates are among the world's highest, massive U.S. aid cuts under Trump have devastated maternal HIV care, collapsing the once robust prevention of mother-to-child transmission program. Over 800 counselors were laid off, and many clinics now lack HIV test kits. PEPFAR, which once funded 67% of the country's HIV response, now covers just 28%, focusing mostly on medication rather than testing. "You can't give PrEP to someone if you don't know their HIV status," warned midwife Mifonye Thutso. Women like this now face long, costly journeys for testing or go without it altogether, fearing they may unknowingly pass HIV to their babies. Number five, Health Day. More than half of infants diagnosed with HIV did not receive postnatal HIV prophylaxis. A new study published in Pediatrics reveals that over half of U.S. infants diagnosed with HIV before their first birthday had not received any postnatal HIV prophylaxis, preventive treatment meant to block transmission after birth. Researchers from the University of Michigan analyzed Medicaid data from over 3 million infants between 2009 and 2021 and found that 52 babies contracted HIV during that time. and 51.9% of them weren't given postnatal medication. Alarmingly, 73.8% of those infants were Black, highlighting racial disparities in care. When newborns aren't getting preventive treatment, it suggests we may be missing HIV infections in pregnant women and missing critical opportunities to intervene, said Dr. Kenjo Inagaki, the study's senior author. And continuing on the topic of children, number 6, Newsweek. Single shot would protect children from HIV for years. A groundbreaking study from the Tulane and California National Primate Research Center suggests that a single gene therapy shot given at birth could protect children from HIV for years. The therapy uses a harmless virus to deliver instructions to muscle cells, turning them into microfactories that produce broadly neutralizing antibodies against multiple HIV strains. In newborn primates, one dose provided strong protection for over 3 years. No booster needed. But timing is critical. The treatment only worked when given within the first few weeks of life, before the immune system matures. This is a one-and-done treatment that fits the critical time when these mothers with HIV in resource-limited areas are most likely to see a doctor, said lead researcher Dr. Amir Ardashir. With 90% of pediatric HIV cases found in sub-Saharan Africa, this approach could offer a more realistic and cost-effective alternative to repeated treatments, especially where healthcare access is limited. Human trials are being planned, and researchers hope this method could one day be adapted to fight other deadly diseases like malaria. Number 7, Medscape. Younger, smaller children show less success with antiretroviral therapy. New data from the Odyssey trial, presented at the 2025 International AIDS Society Conference, shows that younger children with HIV, especially those with low BMI and low CD4 counts, are more likely to fail first-line antiretroviral therapy, even when using dolutegravir-based regimens, which are typically more effective. In the study of 381 children, 75 experienced treatment failure over 96 weeks, 24 on dolutegravir and 51 on standard therapy. Notably, 82% of participants were from Africa, where risk factors like poor nutrition and advanced HIV at treatment start were more common. Lead researcher James Wincall said that findings could help doctors identify at-risk children early, while Dr. Monica Gandhi added that starting ART as soon as possible is key to preventing treatment failure. The researchers are now working on a risk prediction tool based on variables like age, BMI, CD4 percentage, and treatment type. Number 8, the body pro. Weight gain and HIV. It's not the antiretroviral's 3-year study finds. A major 3-year U.S. study presented at the 2025 International AIDS Society Conference found that weight gain in people living with HIV is not primarily caused by antiretroviral medications, as many believed. Our study says categorically that it's not the medicines people have been taking for HIV that are the culprit, Dr. Richard Elion of George Washington University. Instead, the study, one of the largest of its kind, involving 75,000 HIV-positive and 75,000 HIV-negative individuals, found that younger age, being Black, female, having a low CD4 count, and living with certain social disadvantages were the main predictors of significant weight gain. In fact, 12% of participants gained over 10% of their body weight and shifted into a higher BMI category, while 41% didn't gain weight at all. The research highlights how social determinants of health, not HIV meds, are driving weight trends, pointing to the need for more support around nutrition, exercise, and access to resources rather than blaming treatment regimens. Number 9, AIDS map. Broadly neutralizing antibodies plus immune modulator may delay HIV rebound. At the IAS 2025 conference, researchers revealed that combining two broadly neutralizing antibodies with the immune boosting drug NK03, also known as Anktiva, helped over half of participants delay HIV viral rebound after stopping antiretroviral therapy. Among 24 people who paused ART, 58% stayed off treatment for at least 6 months, and one participant remains off ART after more than 30 months. According to lead researcher Professor Marina Kasky from Rockefeller University, some of these participants maintain low-level viremia for a prolonged period of time. The study suggests that pairing bnAbs with N803, an FDA-approved immune modulator for bladder cancer, may both awaken hidden HIV and empower the immune system to control it. While the results are promising, the lack of a control group makes it hard to isolate the exact contribution of N803, and pre-existing resistance to the bnAbs remains a challenge, Still, the findings offer new hope in the search for a functional HIV cure. Number 10, the Body Pro. Large, diverse study backs use of long-acting injectable ART for individuals with viremia. At the IAS 2025 conference, Dr. Ricky Su shared results from a real-world U.S. study showing that long-acting injectable HIV treatment with cabotegravir and rilpivirine works well even in people with detectable viral loads, a group traditionally excluded from this regimen. Using data from the OPERA cohort, 368 viremic individuals, 11% of over 3,300 who received the injections, were studied. Within 6 months, 85% achieved viral suppression below 50 copies per milliliter, and only 1% experienced virologic failure. The participants were notably diverse, with 57% Black, 30% women, 63% lived in the southern U.S., and 29% had a BMI over 30, raising important considerations about equity and access. Dr. Su emphasized that this approach may be especially useful for those struggling with daily pills due to stigma, caregiving responsibilities, or GI side effects. Women did just as well as the overall patient population, he said, challenging assumptions that certain groups may not respond as well. The study also highlighted practical details such as the need for 2-inch needles in patients with higher BMI and pointed to concerns about future Medicaid cuts potentially limiting access to these treatments. Overall, this large and diverse study supports expanding the use of injectable ART beyond currently approved guidelines for more inclusive and flexible HIV care. Number 11, the Body Pro. IAS 2025 HIV drug pipeline includes longer-acting oral prevention and treatment options. At IAS 2025 in Kigali, researchers highlighted exciting advances in longer-acting oral HIV drugs, which could offer more convenient options for both prevention and treatment, especially for those who dislike injections or struggle with daily pill-taking. One standout was MK8527, a once-monthly PrEP pill developed by Merck. In a phase 2 trial involving 350 low-risk participants across the US, South Africa, and Israel, the drug showed no major side effects and no HIV infections, with levels staying steady in the body across all tested doses, which was 3 mg, 6 mg, and 12 mg. The medication was found to be safe and well-tolerated, said Dr. Kenneth Mayer of Harvard, adding that efficacy trials involving over 9,000 participants in 19 countries will soon begin. Meanwhile, a weekly HIV treatment combining islatravir and ulonavirine, MK8507, kept viral loads undetectable in all 82 participants over 24 weeks. Though the trial was paused due to CD4 declines, prompting a switch to a lower 2 mg dose of islatravir in a new study. Also notable, HRF10071, a daily oral maturation inhibitor, tested in newly diagnosed individuals, showed strong viral reductions and long-acting potential, even against drug-resistant HIV, though some resistance mutations were observed. These innovations signal that long-acting oral options may soon reshape how HIV is prevented and managed worldwide. Number 12, EATGM, European AIDS Treatment Group. American Gene Technologies announces promising results from AGT-103T. At the IAS 2025 conference in Kigali, American Gene Technologies presented promising phase 1 results from their HIV cure program using AGT-103T, a gene and cell therapy that enhances HIV-specific immune cells. Using a modified intact proviral DNA assay that distinguishes between therapeutic vector and real HIV sequences, the team found that all 5 evaluable participants experienced a significant reduction in intact HIV proviral DNA, which represents the virus's replication-competent reservoir, or the latent reservoir. In one striking case, a participant's reservoir dropped from approximately 1,664 copies per million CD4 T cells to undetectable levels by day 500, with no rebound for over 2 years. Importantly, the amount of defective proviral DNA remained unchanged, suggesting the therapy selectively targeted the dangerous or replication-competent reservoir. Analytic treatment interruptions were also used to monitor immune control of the virus post-infusion. AGT plans to launch expanded trials in 2026 and is exploring partnerships to scale this potentially game-changing therapy. Dr. Wim David Hardy noted the ability to establish viral control and deplete the intact proviral reservoir holds exciting promise for the field. A lot of you have been waiting for updates from this HIV cure hopeful, and I'm currently working on scheduling an update interview with Jeff Galvin, their CEO, at the moment, so stay tuned for that. Those are your articles for the week. Links to all these articles can be found in the description box below this video. Be sure to like this video, subscribe, and hit that bell so you get a notification every time a new video comes out. And please share this with anyone who might find value in this content. Those are the best ways that you can help support me and my channel. Until next week, cheers.